The views expressed in this podcast do not reflect those of our training institutions or the APA. The information discussed is intended for educational purposes only and should not be used for diagnosis or treatment. Enjoy.
Hello, and welcome to the AJP Residents Journal podcast. My name is Priya Gearin, and I am one of the media editors for the journal. Today, I am thrilled to be speaking with Dr. Ken Duckworth, Senior Medical Director for Behavioral Health for Blue Cross Blue Shield of Massachusetts and Chief Medical Officer of the National Alliance on Mental Illness, or NAMI. Dr. Duckworth, thank you for being here. I know you have shared this on the NAMI website, but would you mind starting us off by telling our listeners a bit about your own personal path to psychiatry?
Sure. Thanks for having me, Priya. So back in the day, before NAMI and before famous people talked about their psychiatric vulnerabilities, often interviewed by me for NAMI good deeds, it was a different world, a lot more shame and silence. So I grew up with a dad who was the greatest guy ever, the most loving, fun, gentle man on earth. And he was hospitalized, I'm going to say 25 times throughout my life, at mostly Northville State Hospital outside of Detroit, where he was transferred after he got fired as a Chef Boyardee salesman after a manic episode when I was 8. So I came back to Boston in part to recapture my roots. As an East Coast boy, I used to visit my grandmother on the seashore where she lived, and I have a little shack on Cape Cod. So I've done my best to recapture some of the East Coast magic that was the early part of my life. So having a dad with bipolar disorder took my core interest, which was in public policy and political science. That was my undergrad major. And I just made a decision to become a psychiatrist to help him. I didn't appreciate how big the workforce shortage was at the time, but I didn't have words for the experience that he was having or that I was having. And because there was no NAMI, there was no place to turn to. There was no group of people who were just like me. I felt like the most alone person on planet Earth. And I just can't describe, you know, how intensely I felt that. I went to visit him when I was at the University of Michigan as an undergrad, sitting in the parking lot and thinking, I know no one who I can talk to, including my own family. Little did I know that 400 miles away, people were forming NAMI at the exact same time. This is 1979, and I was a freshman at the University of Michigan, and I was so alone in my little VW bug, which I bought for $100. And I'm all alone in this little bug for $100, and I had a nice girlfriend, but I couldn't really talk to her about it. I couldn't really articulate the experience. There was just so much shame and secrecy. And so that NAMI began is the beginning of a transformation of sharing personal experience and changing the game about not being alone. So there's support, there's education, but there's also a lot of advocacy. So you've probably heard of mental health parity. That's a NAMI win. You've probably heard of the 300 early psychosis programs across America. Checkbox for NAMI. You've probably heard of the 988 legislation where people with psychiatric illness will not be visited by police if we can execute this, but rather will be intervened with or responded to by people with mental health training and de-escalation as a core of their construct. So we support each other, we teach each other, we fight for more research money, and we do a lot of good advocacy. So NAMI's a very beautiful part of my life. I volunteered there for 10 years. And I didn't even know NAMI was a thing for a long time. And I'm delighted that you're having me to talk about it. NAMI is free. People give money to NAMI. NAMI's in my will, for example. People donate to NAMI. Individual contributions represent the vast majority. This gives free educational programs. Family to family, evidence-based program. This is Psych Services from 2011. More hopeful, more empowered families. NAMI basics for families with kids who have serious emotional vulnerabilities. We have these models of these programs that are free and omni-available across America. There's about 650 chapters. So if you're listening to this, you know, in Ann Arbor, Michigan, you know, one of my stomping grounds, connect with NAMI Washtenaw County. They love doctors at NAMI. This is how I stumbled into NAMI. And I think that my passion about having a family member and my persistent interest in policy was intriguing to them. I was the commissioner of mental health in Massachusetts when the phone rang and I was offered my dream job for no pay. And I took it because, you know, when you get your dream job to come across the phone line, it doesn't come a lot. They pay me now, happily, and I've been doing this for 17 years. So NAMI is a beautiful organization. They love doctors. They love psychiatrists who want to be in service to this shared mission of advancing care for people who live with mental health problems. It's also a very beautiful organization. So there's nothing to say about it that isn't superbly positive. I just recruited a young woman who was just a resident at Mass General Hospital perhaps 4 or 5 years ago. I just recruited her to be my associate medical director. Her name is Christine Crawford. So, you know, stumble on to people, you know, that are doing jobs that you find interesting. Teach with them, hang out with them, have coffee with them. And what do you know, when they think, hey, I think we finally have money to hire a helper, you could be that helper. Might be true at NAMI, might be true at some other organization, right? This is one of the pathways to, you know, career development.
That's great. Now you covered a whole lot. And I guess one thing I'm curious about is, you know, for residents, people who are interested in working for NAMI or with NAMI, what does that look like on a day-to-day? Like, I imagine you probably are doing a lot as in your role. But for other people, are there, you know, more clinical duties? Is it a lot of administrative work? What does it typically look like?
NAMI is, you know, 500,000 volunteers. We're an army of people who get it. You love somebody with a mental health problem? You get it. You have a mental health problem. It doesn't leave you. So I'm a part-time doctor for this amazing peer organization. So I have a very unusual job. So when I go to a conference, I usually make sure when they invite me to speak for NAMI that we have 2 or 3 people with lived experience who've managed to live well with their condition or a family member. I happen to be a family member in addition to being a doc. But my day-to-day life is I run teaching webinars. I run little podcasts like this. In a way, I comment on many studies that are out there. So I do a lot of media stuff. I was on Chris Cuomo a couple times this year, and I'm a regular on WGBH now. Like, people are interested in talking about mental health. You've picked a great time to enter psychiatry, and I mean a great time. So when I went into psychiatry, it was kind of like, oh, you're going to med school. Hey, that's really great. Oh, God, not psychiatry. You know, and I'm like, listen, I know the cardiologists drive nicer cars, but I'm actually really interested in this thing, which was kind of hardwired into me through my childhood, through my beloved father. But it turns out people think it's cool now. And I experienced this at my local community pool. 15 years ago, I would tell people I was a psychiatrist in the locker room, and people would say, oh, can you read my thoughts? About 5 years ago, people started to say, all right, my brother-in-law's on Seroquel, and he's gaining weight, and it's not really helpful. Now, I'm looking for a therapist now, and I really need to find somebody because my brother killed himself, as I think I might have told you the last time you were in this pool, right? So what you realize is the status of psychiatry and the transformation of attitudes, many people get credit for that, but NAMI's been very big on this. One of the things I do for NAMI is I interview famous people with mental health vulnerabilities. I do this on Instagram Live, and I do this, you know, in other settings. People come to us and say, hi, I want to join this club. You know, I opened my email one day and a family had left $500,000 for NAMI to conduct research. And so what did I do? I worked with a group of people with lived experience in their families, and I put out a grant proposal to the academic centers in McLean and the University of Michigan. I did not pull any strings there for my alma mater. They had the best proposals. And so we gave a 5-year grant to support psychiatric research that is in concert with NAMI's mission. So they would select somebody like a PGY-5 or a PGY-6 and a fellowship. And a family just wanted to make a difference for their son who had schizophrenia. So this is the kind of thing I get to do. NAMI's essentially the greatest job I could ever imagine for me, Ken. It's only part-time, and it's in the wrong city. So I live here in Boston, and the job is in Washington, D.C. So I used to take so many airplanes, I began to develop a first-name basis with some of the flight attendants on the shuttle. Since the pandemic, of course, everything's virtual. But it's an important organization, and I think it's changed the entire equation around talking about mental health. And so every day, you know, is something new and interesting and different. But primarily, my job is to get the science to the people who need it. It's to form relationships with researchers and clinicians and ask them to help us, to come to our convention, to give talks, to participate in our webinars. Because the idea is our website is now the most popular website for people where people go for mental health, which is mind-blowing because we were not there 5 years ago. But it's impressive. People come to NAMI, I think, for a couple reasons. One is we have a lot of first-person blogs. It's just first-person experience. It's authentic. And the other thing which I think is compelling is any study we cite, you click on it, you can read the study. Just make it as transparent as possible. You know and I know that the studies are imperfect. We have a lot of smart people. And when you have a smart person who really wants to figure out the answer to a question, they want to actually read the studies, not my simple-minded translation of a study. And so we try to translate the study. So, our market share in the media has continued to grow. And, it's just another piece of the puzzle. You should know your local NAMI. You should send your patients to the local NAMI. And if you're interested, volunteer. Get to know them.
I know you mentioned a bit about, you know, a couple of different residents who you've worked with or fellows over the years and their experience with NAMI. Do you know of any, like, residency-wide initiatives to be more integrated with NAMI, like across the country, or any specific programs?
If you want to do more with NAMI, send me an email. My name is Ken, and I work for NAMI. It's like a vanity license plate. Ken@NAMI.org, and say, my university wants to formally connect with NAMI. Des Moines University, which cranks out through their DO school, the largest number of primary care doctors in America, all of NAMI's programming is integrated into their curriculum. This is a big development that's very positive. So seriously, we would love to partner with more. We're a volunteer army. You should know about NAMI. You should know about the programmings. You should know where the local meetings are, and we want to work with you.
That's great. Probably the first time I formally was introduced to NAMI was my intern year of residency. And, you know, our program does the annual fundraising walk. Did that with a few faculty and co-residents. It was a good time, and it was a huge turnout, I think, that goes to show how big of an organization it is, just seeing this one small fundraiser in the grand scheme of things, and knowing those are going on all over the country.
All over America. I think there's close to 100 walks now. So, you know, if you're interested in connecting to NAMI, you know, raise $100 and show up at the walk and introduce yourself to people. They love doctors. I can't emphasize this enough. They love doctors who want to be joined with them in terms of support, education, and advocacy. They will treat you like gold. I really guarantee it.
One of my clinical interests is actually early episode psychosis, and I know NAMI's done a lot of work with getting those types of clinics integrated across the country. What was that like? I mean, you've been with NAMI for 17 years. How did that roll out? What was that process like?
Yeah. It's been a very interesting experience, Priya, because NAMI, like psychiatry, wasn't thinking about psychosis through a public health lens. I want to emphasize this. So, you know, I suggested this in perhaps 2005. It did not go over well at NAMI. I was thinking, how about we think about an earlier intervention program? Now, again, the Australians, the Europeans hadn't done all the fabulous work, but it was starting to happen, right? It was beginning to happen in other countries, just beginning. And what I realized is that NAMI wasn't ready for it, and neither was psychiatry, right? Psychiatry treated everyone, you know, as if they had stage four cancer, right? And you had psychosis, and you had it for 10 years, or maybe we'll get to clozapine, you know, and that's pretty much kind of the conceptualization. And so the idea that we're friends with NIMH, like we love NIMH, we hang out with them, we meet with them, we advocate for research devoted to our cause. And as this work began to develop, this early psychosis work, we said, hey, how about we advocate with Congress to have a block grant that funds this model through SAMHSA? And the answer is that's exactly what happened. And we brought people who'd been in a few of the programs. We brought them to Congress. We advocated. We got our army of people across America to talk to their congressmen. And, you know, it was a lot of leadership decisions, but we really wanted this. And what's cool about these things is many of these ideas come from a few people, and then the good ones really can get some momentum. And first episode of Psychosis Work is a great example of that. And people contact me pretty regularly with family members who have early psychosis or something like that. And I'm happy to say, go to the Stanford PepNet website. It has all 300 programs. It's exactly where they are, what their phone numbers are. Call them. Do the beginning of the process. I was called by a friend of a friend, and the program at Prep in San Francisco was 2 blocks from his home for his daughter to go to. Just to give you an idea of how far we've gone. Every state except Arkansas, I believe, has such a program at this time, and I've challenged NAMI Arkansas to see what they can do about that, because if you happen to have an early psychosis in Little Rock, there's no reason except for geography that you shouldn't have access to the best care. And again, this model of coordinated specialty care is into support, strengths, finding out what you want. It's not into pathos. So typically these programs are for young people. They're often in a separate space. They're affirming, they're positive. They're very much into education and employment. Light on meds, but not zero meds. It's not a religious position, right? And I think the idea of these programs, if you can get into this program, you can have your goals and your identity as opposed to treatment as usual, which is less optimal for those kind of things. So I strongly encourage you to pursue this. The literature continues to grow. Bob Heinzen at the National Institute of Mental Health is the mastermind behind this entire thing. NAMI gave him one of our Distinguished Service Awards last year. We just believe in this. And one of the things that happened at NAMI was very interesting to me, and this was noteworthy about how people can evolve in their thinking. NAMI came up with a strategic plan that I did not manipulate. And the number one goal is intervene earlier in the strategic plan of NAMI. So this just speaks to the thinking. I was there 15 years ago, but didn't go over very well. And what I came to realize is the whole field had moved, and people recognized that their 40-year-old son may not benefit from this. But it's much more than that. It's much more about creating the conditions for the next person's son. And altruism is a huge piece of NAMI. Of course, people want better services for their own son. But, you know, an early psychosis program isn't going to help you if you're 60 and your son is 38, right? Like, they're not early in their course. And those people are some of the biggest champions because they want to leave this earth knowing that things are better. And this is what's very beautiful about the advocacy movement. People want to make change.
Absolutely. What do you think has changed from the early 2000s to now, or even before the 2000s? Why do you think people are more interested in investing in mental health or talking about it in our culture today?
That's a really good question. I'm not sure there's one answer. But NAMI has a program called In Our Own Voice, which is a free program where two people with mental health conditions come to your employment, your hospital, your clinic, your day job, your pharma company, whatever you do, they will come. Contact your local NAMI. And this is based on the research work of Patrick Corrigan from the University of Chicago. And he found that attitudes improve when you meet someone who has a mental health condition. So running ads at 5 a.m. is fine. It doesn't change people's attitudes, right? This literature is now fairly conclusive. It's contact with people that you can identify with in some way. This person reminds me a little bit of my cousin. I went to a guy in high school like this. I remember that guy, right? Like, so the idea is you form a connection. So In Our Own Voice is given thousands of times across America every week. And it is one of the ways I think this has begun to normalize this conversation. One amazing person from Iowa invented a program called Ending the Silence. They just made it up. This is an educational program for middle school and high school. It's given thousands of times a year now across America. So the idea is you're an eighth grader, right? You may have some vulnerabilities of your own. People come and they talk about their own mental health journeys, how to get help, how to think about it, how to problem solve. What we're doing is normalizing all of this, right? This is just becoming part of the human condition, which makes sense because these are very common problems, and they're not going to become easier as we go through this pandemic. You know, the mental health piece has been substantial as another wave of the pandemic. So NAMI's been very interested in facilitating openness about this, and I do think that's been quite successful. I think the mental health parity law also changed the rules, and this is one of the reasons I joined a health plan. And people always say, my God, you went from community mental health to a health plan. And I'm like, well, guys, I spent my 40s testifying before Congress for mental health parity. Why wouldn't I join a health plan and see how I could leverage that into getting more services for people? And so that's exactly what's happened. So in my particular health plan, we have no paperwork, no prior auths. We've eliminated just about every copay imaginable. Like, the idea is you can use mental health parity to compare what's happening at the health plan to what's happening medically. So for those of you who've had to contact a insurance carrier at 3 o'clock in the morning with a suicidal patient in an emergency room, I'd encourage you to consider working for that company and getting rid of that, because they don't do that on medicine. That's a violation of mental health parity, in my opinion. And I made that argument, and in 6 months, I got rid of it. Mental health parity means the rules need to be the same. So if orthopedic surgeons have to beg to put their patients into the hospital with compound fractures, or people with cardiac events have to call the health plan and ask, say, can I please admit this person? That actually would be parity. You can't have it harder for people with mental health and addiction. And so one of my mentees went to another health plan and made that change after, you know, watching me do it. I'm like, this is what needs to happen. Bright young people need to be willing to take on jobs that are, you know, in some ways more complex and some ways different than seeing patients. I love seeing patients, and I believe in people who see patients. But I was always been very interested in kind of the public policy aspect of things, and removing the barriers in health insurance is one such way that you can operate. There are many other places that you can find your own voice.
Absolutely. I mean, it's this lasting impact that's affecting thousands and thousands of people every day and year.
I just want to remind people, this is a potential career path, because the obvious stages of this are health plans are evil, health plans are bad. Another stage of thinking about this is part of the public health environment that we live in. So to me, you know, the opportunity to join a health plan and to liberalize benefits, leveraging mental health parity, is another piece. And because of that liberalization, this is a long answer to your question, that's helped people see that you can get help. You don't have to only pay privately. You don't have to feel ashamed because nobody else is doing it. You know, I've gotten very good at spending Blue Cross Blue Shield of Massachusetts money on mental health and addictions, and they keep hanging me around. You know, like, they could have cut me loose at any time. They know who I am. I work for NAMI part-time. I mean, I'm not a moderate on this. I have a very strong belief system, and Blue Cross Blue Shield of Massachusetts just did a marketing campaign for open enrollment on how good we are at mental health. This, in a way, is the zenith of my accomplishments there. They actually have agreed with me that this is what employers want for their people, which is novel. It's the first time I think a health plan has gone long on promoting mental health. It's just one, you know, little piece of this entire puzzle. And there's 100 ways to express yourself in the field of psychiatry, which is why you're so blessed to have taken this on. Because when I was your age, Priya, you could, you know, see a patient in your clinic and they in your private practice, and they had $500 of mental health benefits per year, and they could go to the hospital twice a year. This is all true. And the idea is you could see your, you know, diabetic doctor twice a week, and you could go in and out of the hospital five times a year. But after two hospitalizations or after $500 of outpatient care, you were done. That's why we had to have mental health parity, which remains one of the great, you know, NAMI innovations, but it's not over. It has to be fought, you know, hand to hand. And as you probably know, there's lawsuits happening different parts of the country about interpreting mental health parity. And I view this as a very positive thing. So it's not a light switch on and off. It's a conversation about interpretation.
I'm sure a lot of our listeners are wondering how you even got that conversation going. I mean, how you even created that initial change, you know, at your health plan.
Well, they want to do the right thing. So they do have really nice people and good people. And so I said, hey, guys, do you guys have to call in for orthopedic patients? And they're like, no. I'm like, well, why do my guys have to call in for psychiatric patients? They're like, well, I don't know. I think we've always done it that way. And they're like, oh, maybe we should change that. I said, well, there's this whole mental health parity thing. And why don't we just do the right thing? I said, okay. So that wasn't even a battle. But they didn't see it. Right? They didn't see it. And it took me to arrive there. And I happen to know this from my experience, is that, you know, this is a tremendous waste of life force to be arguing with a health plan at 3 o'clock in the morning, right? And so what we did is we got the same number of days paid for as you would for a medical visit. So the first 2 days are on the house, and then the hospital has to call us and say, hey, what do you got here? What are we working with? That sort of thing. But the first couple of days were just paid for. No hassle, no muss, no fuss. So some of them were easier than others. When I pitched eliminating the copay and the deductible for methadone in the middle of the opiate crisis, people were surprised that we didn't have an opiate network for methadone. And again, with Obamacare, sicker people joined the private health plans, which is why I was interested in it, because I've done mostly community mental health in my career. And I'm like, you know, methadone is a thing, and if people have a $5,000 deductible, they don't go. So they didn't even know that they didn't have opiate treatment programs. To make a long story short, we made an opiate treatment contract with every opiate provider, methadone provider. We eliminated the copay and the deductible, and the use went up 800%, which means people's lives are being saved, right? But again, it isn't something that they conceptualized, because back in the day, private insurance didn't have people with these more complex needs, at least in their minds, right? It's a common misconception, I think.
Yeah. Well, those are inspiring words. As we're coming to a close, are there any, you know, last words of advice, especially for, you know, you've mentioned different ways to get involved with NAMI, but any last words of advice for residents, especially interested in community psychiatry?
Boy, advice, you know. I was encouraged to pursue what I was interested in. And if I don't know anybody else who's ever worked for NAMI, and none of my friends work for health plans. And they used to make fun of me until I got rid of all the paperwork. And then they're like, hey, Ken, that was cool. Could you do some more? So the bottom line is I was interested in the public health and mental health, the family and personal experience, and advocating to change the equation. That was my particular constellation. And if you go to bed thinking about neuroreceptors and circuitry, do that. If you really are interested in family work, do that. If you want to do homeless outreach work, it's beautiful work and I've done it, do that. Like, the idea is, don't constrain yourself to think the only thing that exists is outpatient private practice, right? If you want to do outpatient private practice, you're going to have a great life and you're going to help people. Most of my friends do outpatient private practice. They're all happy, but I'm happy too. And I think the idea is I followed my own personal set of interests, and I would really just encourage you to do the same. And if you're interested in NAMI or the family experience or the first person experience, contact your local NAMI. So we have 650 chapters. In every major town in America, there's a group of people that are fabulous, welcoming, and devoted to a mission to change the world for people who live with mental health conditions.
Yeah, well, thank you so much for taking the time. I really appreciate it, and I'm sure our listeners will as well.
Thank you for having me, Priya. Thank you for all you're doing on this podcast series. It's so great that you've, you know, been able to connect with this community, and I'm honored to be on this.